You're going to hear a very wild story tonight on Coast to Coast. Those of you who are brand new to the program, Michael Fitzhugh Bell was back with us about a year ago when we talked about the invisible crime. Well, this is the invisible crime part two. It's a whistleblower. Michael is a victim of what is referred to as an unacknowledged special access program, apparently created by the U.S. government, believed to be part of a military black ops portion of the shadow government. Bell is victimized for the misuse of advanced nanotechnology, biomedical devices embedded throughout his body, using clandestine government classified technologies. The first book that he wrote demonstrated this and used actual verified doctors' reports and documented medical images to prove his fact. Bell is under constant attack by bioelectronic torture weapons, 24/7, and a nonstop assault on his life. We'll find out why. Fighting on the front lines of this battle of survival every day. And Michael, is it any better since you were last with me?
George, it's great to be here. I would have to say my targeting has escalated, especially with the release of this brand new book.
They did not want this out, did they?
No, it's interesting you said that because here's an interesting fact that happened with this new book. My publisher just informed me a couple of weeks ago that someone or some group tried to sabotage my new book during the submission process. An extremely sophisticated program was found embedded into my manuscript that corrupted, scrambled, and encrypted the text, making it impossible to read. Luckily, my publisher was able to extract the program after several weeks of diligent reformatting, but he said he'd never seen anything like it in 25 years of publishing. And he said it was no coincidence that it happened to my book. And he said, if anyone's questioning the validity of what I've written about, someone has gone to great lengths to prevent it from being published.
Absolutely. And Michael, for those people who did not hear your show with me December 29th, 2016, or new listeners, tell us a little bit about this invisible crime. What has happened to you, and when did this start?
Okay, I can tell you just a quick summary. What happened to me is that I was a screenwriter out in Hollywood, California, and one night a group broke into my apartment and drugged and abducted me. And I remember bits and pieces of the abduction. I remember frightening masks. I remember being on a surgical table at one point. I also remember waking up the next morning and my body was riddled with these tiny surgical incision scars. And I didn't know what to make of it. I consulted with private investigators and an ex-CIA agent, which informed me that it sounded like what had happened to me is that I'd become what's known as a targeted individual, and that I had perhaps been implanted with advanced nanotechnology biomedical devices. So I traveled around the world collecting medical evidence, MRIs, ultrasounds, all clearly showing foreign objects, which I published in the first book. And for people that don't really know what this is, it's believed to be a massive field test, an illegal clinical trial in human experimentation using classified technologies. It's believed to be the most advanced weapon system ever created by mankind, and it embodies every bit of science, neuroscience, psychology, medicine, mathematics, physics, and all war tactics, techniques, and methods, and basically the sum of all human knowledge.
In your opinion, how many people are out there like you?
In the new book, I have a chapter called "The Statistics Are Staggering," and it's estimated that 1% of the global population are victims of this crime. That's out of a population of 7.5 billion people. That would be roughly around 75 million victims worldwide, of which the signature, as I describe in the new book, signature or hard targets people that are at the highest levels of victimization are the 1% of the 1%. So roughly, people like me, there's 750,000 people like me around the world at my level of targeting in my research.
Have you ever tried to get any of these things extracted from your body?
Yes, I have. I did have one removed, which I was allowed to photograph before it was taken away from me in my first book. And it clearly is something that's not part of the human body, certainly not organic.
What does it look like?
It was kind of oblong. It was about the size of a Tic Tac, and it was removed from my left lower front jaw. And it was interesting because when I went to the doctor's office, the doctor said, I didn't tell him what I thought it was. I just had this little bump underneath my gum line in my lower jaw. And so I arranged to have it removed in his office. But when I came back a week later for the removal, the doctor obviously had been talked to or spoken to by someone. And whereas before, the first visit, he said he'd let me keep whatever he removed. Whatever it was, he would let me keep it. When I came to have it removed, he wouldn't let me keep it. And he did let me photograph it, so I did include those photographs. But he would not let me keep it, and he said he had to send it to pathology, which declared it some kind of a mucoid formation, which I know was not true.
And how many of these things do you think are in your body now?
Well, I have scars. At last count, I have 250 corresponding and symmetrical scars from head to toe on exactly opposite points of each part of my body. And the exactly the same kind of scar from the foreign object that was removed from the inside of my gum and my mouth. So I have many. At the very least, I have a multitude of these, what I believe to be nanotechnology biomedical devices. Just like the first one, I can't see these scars being anything other than something that was unnatural, that was forced upon me.
Are they there to control you, to kill you? What do you think they're there for?
I think they're there for several different reasons, George. I think that they're there for to monitor me, to surveillance me, to track, to view, to interact with me, to read my thoughts, believe to be able to read my thoughts in a process which I describe in the new book is synthetic telepathy, which is a bi-directional communication between the human mind and the supercomputer. So that's something that I described. That's the title of the new book is Targeted Individual Synthetic Telepathy and Global Criminal Biomedical Human Experimentation.
Michael, why do you think you were picked, selected, taken?
I have some ideas, but I'm afraid to pinpoint the source for fear of backlash, but I have an idea that it was some form of retribution from something that happened to me when I was about 19 years old, and by a very, very powerful, wealthy, influential family with strong political and government ties. I can say that much without incriminating anyone or accusing
right.
anyone, but I believe that it's connected to that.
You think this group, this family, is behind this?
I believe somebody connected to the family, and I believe that I've been told by people that know a lot more than me, including an ex-CIA agent, that the perpetrators behind my particular crime are part of a group called the Cabal, spelled C-A-B-A-L, not to be confused with the Kabbalah. A cabal is a secret group or government faction extremely secretive and extremely powerful and influential.
What do they want with you, Michael? And I say that in all due respect. What do they want with you?
That's a great question. A lot of people say, why would they pick you? What's so special about you? I believe initially it had to do with some form of retribution, some kind of punishment for me. But anyone, any targeted individual, and there are different levels of being targeted. Certainly when you compare what happens to one person to that of another, it's certainly very different for each person, but I believe that this is a program, an experimental program, human experimentation, a real crime against humanity, similar to what happened in the concentration camps in Nazi Germany. And it's
maybe that's
what I and I mean, what could be. What could be a more dangerous weapon than being able to... And this crime is being scaled to the entire population eventually. That's the long-term goal. So I believe it's human enslavement and depopulation seem to be the general focus. But also at the highest levels, I believe the data is being collected on me and... other targeted individuals for purposes of study and experimentation, completely illegal.
I would say, are these implants embedded in your brain by any chance?
I have some, they only show up in MRIs and ultrasounds, and I have MRIs that I published in the first book that I have circled and it's easy to see that there is a foreign object and several. Yes, I do have several that are in my brain, I believe. Certainly the MRIs certainly show it. But they're throughout my entire body. And it's a crime against humanity. It's really an atrocity what's happened to me.
Are you hearing voices in your head, Michael?
I don't hear the voices. I have a different format of this targeting. Mine is referred to as silent subliminal sound presentation. So I don't hear voices like a lot of the other targeted individuals, but I do hear a very loud electronic sound constantly.
That would drive me crazy.
You can't turn it off. Once it was turned on, it was. It's been going since this particular part of the targeting has been going on. The moment I still remember the moment it was turned on in late 2008, on October 13th, 2008. I remember the moment that I was, as I describe in my book, activated. And it's never been the same since then.
Coming up on 9 years, and it still continues.
That's right.
Got to be frustrating. Do you think you're feeding information back to somebody? And if you are, what is it?
I believe what's happened to me is a test, an experiment to see how much a person can be altered or changed through a process called trauma-based behavior modification. If you're able to slowly over a period of time influence or change a person's urges or emotions, you can effectively change the way that they think and to an extent control them.
There's no question about it. Do you feel pain?
Oh, yeah. I feel, in my first book, I described what happened to me, but I didn't want to complain too much to the reader because I realized that nobody really wants to hear somebody else's complaints. But in this second book, that was one of the criticisms I had from some of the other targeted individuals. They said, listen, if you write a sequel, you got to include the torture. You have
oh,
to.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
this second book, I've clearly tried my best to put the reader in my shoes, seeing life through my eyes, knowing what it's like to be a targeted individual, and the pain, both the physical torture and the psychological terror that is that I'm being attacked with 24/7. Is something I go into great detail in this second book.
Whereabouts do you think the members of the cabal might be, Michael? Are they in L.A., Chicago, New York? Where are they?
I don't know their headquarters, if they have one. I think it's global. I believe that there are members of this group everywhere. I believe that perhaps there is some headquarters somewhere. I'm not aware. I don't know that much about it, of exactly where they are and who the people that are directly responsible for me personally, my handlers, are what they're referred to, the people that are actually in control of manipulating my dreams, torturing me remotely through these classified technologies. I don't really know where they are, and that's part of the mystery that this group does not want anyone to know that information.
With these sounds in your head and voices, I assume, do you think or did you feel that you were going nuts?
I knew something terrible was happening to me. I didn't know exactly what it was. I don't think any targeted individual, when they first become a victim, really has any idea what they're up against. And when they try to explain what's happened to them to other people, it's simply the crime is so sophisticated and it's so advanced that it's difficult for people to comprehend the level of this technology that's being used on targeted individuals. I also wanted to add that something very similar has happened to the U.S. diplomats in Cuba. They claimed that they were attacked and tortured by ultrasonic acoustic weapons, causing severe headaches, pain, and permanent hearing loss. And then also it was very interesting how quickly the FBI and the medical services and doctors were so quick to respond and seemed quite familiar with the effects of these dangerous covert weapons. Yet, targeted individuals that are being attacked by what is believed to be identical covert weapons are dismissed and declared mentally ill to cover up the truth.
It is pretty dramatic stuff. And has there been a point in your life where you thought you were going to lose it because of all the sounds and the manipulation and things that were happening?
Well, I'll tell you, there's two things there. The most, when people ask, you know, what is the most disturbing aspect of this crime, I would say certainly specifically the electronic sleep deprivation.
Let's get into that when we come back on Coast to Coast AM.
Get daily show updates right to your inbox for free with the Coast Zone newsletter. Sign up today at coasttocoastam.com.
Okay, we are back with Michael Fitzhugh Bell as we're talking about his latest work, The Invisible Crime Part 2, and the subtitle, A Targeted Individual, Synthetic Telepathy, and Global Criminal Biomedical Human Experimentation. Is this happening worldwide, do you think, Michael?
I believe it is. Since I wrote the first book, I've been contacted by thousands and thousands of other targeted individuals who describe nearly exactly the same type of covert, remote torture and organized stalking, electronic harassment, and to a greater degree, remotely induced mind control that I do. And I have to say that I have a spot on both of my websites that allows people to contact me and make a comment, and I do my best to answer all of them, but I've learned a lot from the people, and some of the people have left their phone numbers, and I was intrigued enough to call many of them, and they confirmed pretty much everything that I've written about in both books.
You were talking about sleep deprivation. What happens?
Yes, the electronic sleep deprivation for me is something that happens to me as I'm drifting off to sleep, as I'm relaxing, when I first go to sleep, and throughout the night, each and every night, just at the moment where I'm drifting off between being awake and conscious and going into sleep, I will be hit with a very hard electronic jolt or a shock, which instantly wakes me up and gives me a kind of a panicked feeling. I could only describe that panicked feeling as when you're confronted with something of when your life's in jeopardy, when you're severely frightened, when you've misplaced something, like for instance your passport, your keys, and you realize for a split second that terrible panicking when you're that awful feeling of not being in control and being in fear. That is what I'm hit with as I'm trying to go to sleep each and every night, and the best I can do is basically lie there and rest, but I don't get the same sleep, and I'm denied my rapid eye movement, my REM sleep, that I would normally be getting under normal conditions if I was not a targeted individual. But I would have to say, when people say what are the worst aspects of being a victim of this, I would say, well, certainly physically, the electronic sleep deprivation, but also too, the terrible reality that people just don't believe you. That frustration of knowing that you are a victim of something that's very real, especially in my case where I traveled around the world collecting medical evidence that is documented, that is verified, that demonstrates and proves that certainly in my specific case that I have been implanted with what only could be described as biomedical devices. But having that truth and living and being and experiencing the organized stalking, which is a real separate terror all by itself. Some people only receive certain aspects of this crime and the many sub-crimes that come off as part of the main crime. And I believe that not being believed by family and friends is beyond frustrating for the targeted individual.
I think so, too. Let's get into now some of the things that have been going on and what they're doing. Do they try to control you at all, or are they just primarily monitoring you?
I believe I'm being conditioned slowly over time. I'm aware of it. I believe that some people, this process is happening to them, and perhaps they're not being targeted as overtly as I am in terms of the organized stalking and the manpower and the multitude of people that it takes to accomplish this crime. I would say that definitely my thoughts have been corrupted and are attempting to be changed. And I have to say, it's interesting that you say that, George, because I wanted to mention this. During my radio interviews like this one right now.
All right.
I believe my perpetrators are using similar frequencies that were being used on the diplomats in Cuba to diminish my ability to communicate effectively to the listeners, to some extent jamming and dulling my focus and disorienting me as I try to form and convey thoughts. Sometimes, mid-sentence, I can have my memory fogged and forget what I'm talking about. And, you know, experiencing that to some degree could compromise my credibility, which I believe the perpetrators are trying desperately to accomplish.
That could be. That could be. Now, at what point have some people, Michael, said, come on, what a crazy, far-fetched story?
Right.
Does this happen to you?
I'm met with people I have three. I tell you, with my specific story, I have one of three things that happen. I try to explain it to someone, what's happened to me, and right off the bat, they're going to not believe me and think that I'm crazy or mentally ill. And then I have a second group of people that would, because I have been able to not only show them the covert surgery scars on my body, but on theirs as well. I found them on every single person that I have come in contact with since I've become a victim. And these are people that aren't aware that they're target individuals, but they have the same scar pattern that I do. So one group of people they don't believe me at all. The second group, because I have so much evidence in both books, and I'm able to point out the scars on them, mm-hmm. they believe me to some extent, but it's just so fantastic. They're still a little skeptical. Then I have my third group of people that believe everything that I've said in both books and are absolutely terrified. I've had some people say, you know, I was doing just fine until you told me about the contents of both of your books, and now I'm a little upset and I'm a little worried. I kind of wish you hadn't told me that. And then I always say, you know, it's better to know than to not know.
How much of this is controlling mind control?
Well, the mind control process is really, there's three parts to this crime, really, three basic parts. And there are many other crimes that are attached to it and sub-crimes. But basically, it is, for the most part, the organized stalking, the electronic harassment, and then there's the remotely induced mind control with the dream manipulation, the mood alteration, the urge induction, the memory fogging. So those three aspects come together to form what I call the invisible crime. But it's more than just one crime. It's many different crimes, and there are so many different classified technologies that are being used and incorporated right now to accomplish this crime and its end product, which is human enslavement and perhaps even depopulation. But certainly mind control is being attempted on me. I know that. My dreams are not the same dreams that I used to have. I can see that whatever's happening to me has taken a lot of manpower and a lot of resources to make this happen. So, and in my research, since World War II, when Project Paperclip first was exposed at the end of World War II, the human experimentation process, the trials that were going on during the Nazi regime, never really stopped. And a lot of people don't know that those those German scientists were brought over to the United States and continued the human experimentation and the mind experimentation. And it's never stopped. And it's estimated that since World War II, it's estimated trillions of dollars have been poured into this program. And they're not about to stop anytime soon. So at my level of targeting, which is not the same, I know only because I compare my story to other targeted individuals, and I'll explain things to them, and I say, and many of them are experiencing what I'm experiencing, and sometimes things even beyond which I'm experiencing. But most I will hear when I go into the details, I say, some of them will say, yeah, that doesn't happen to me. I don't experience that particular aspect of the crime. But I would have to say that mind control, I have to say that certainly to some extent, I have been, my mind has been corrupted. And I'm aware of it, which is, it's disturbing. And it's sad. And it's an atrocity what's happened to me and other targeted individuals, that someone without permission, without my knowledge, without my consent, is experimenting on me for the benefit of the 1%, the people that are in control of the world. We have the 1% that are being experimented on, like me, and then you have, on the other end of the spectrum, you have the 1% that are in control. And my whatever is being learned from me and gleaned from my experimentation is being collected. That data is being collected at the highest levels.
If you were able to face the people who have been doing this to you, what would you be asking them or talking to them about?
Well, I know why they're doing it. It's obviously to, these people are to more or lesser degree sociopaths, psychopathic in their thought process, with little or no regard for humanity, for their fellow man. I've thought many times, what would I do? What would I say to my immediate perpetrators? It's certainly anger and frustration are the things that come to mind first, but I mean, more than anything else, I would just like to see this stop, and I would like to see the people, obviously, that are responsible held accountable for what they've done to not only myself, but to many other targeted individuals and people around the world like me. And there are also a large group of people that have absolutely no idea. See, I'm being overtly targeted. I'm being very well made aware of what's happening to me. They want me to know, especially when I go out into the community and experience the community, the intimidation tactics and the organized stalking. That's not being done secretly. That's part of my trauma-based behavior modification, seeing these people, interacting with them, having people, and when I go into stores, when I travel, I will be very aggressively stalked. I will receive very, very aggressive organized stalking, and they want me to know what's happening to me, and I know it. And they're trying to provoke some kind of a reaction. They're trying to elicit a response out of me. They want me to act out. They're trying to provoke me into some kind of altercation, to get me arrested, to perhaps have me mentally committed. That's what happens to many.
You're like a guinea pig, aren't you?
Correct, George. Sadly, that's a very accurate description of what's happened to me.
Male, female, does it matter? How many they have?
mean in terms of...
people that are being targeted.
That are being targeted. It's both. And it's as well as senior citizens and children. It's terrible to see what's and also people that targeted individuals that have pets. Their pets are, from what I'm, what's being reported to me, the pets are being terrorized or blinded or poisoned or just killed. And people's children are being harassed. This crime knows no borders. It knows no limitations. It only seems to escalate over time.
Well, if they do it over time, why aren't they stopping? I mean, how much more do they need to grab from you?
Well, I believe that at this point, the amount of experimentation, the years of data that they've been collecting on me, I don't know what's enough. I also think that people, a lot of the people that I see in the news that are being, that have somewhat normal lives and suddenly will have an incident where they, for lack of a better word, flip out and are either trying to hurt people or kill groups of people.
Let's take some calls with you, Michael, when we come back on Coast to Coast AM.
Find out more about tonight's guest. Log on to coasttocoastam.com.
Welcome back. Michael Fitzhugh Bell with us. Michael, how does society react to people like yourself who say that you're the victim of these targets and that all these strange things have been happening? I mean, do they react with open arms or they think you're a little crazy? What happens?
Well, I get a mixed reaction, but for the people that are curious, all I do is ask to look at two places. If I examine their hands or look behind their ears, and I'm able to find the telltale covert surgery scars, there's not much they can do to defend themselves under that pretext. When I find the scars on them and point them out to them, they're usually shocked, and they don't know. They're really blown away by pointing that specific aspect out. But yes, I'm met with criticism, skeptical reactions, people that simply don't believe me. But then I do have a lot of other people that will say, you know, I don't doubt everything that you put in your book. Well, everything that's going on in the world, there's even other things that seem to be beyond that. So what you've written about in your book certainly seems like it could be possible. So I get mixed reactions, but it's difficult to try to convince someone, certain people, unless they read both books and look at all of the medical evidence and the verified proof that I have, especially in the first book showing with the biomedical implants, the people that I get a chance to talk to and if they're really listening, as I said, especially with the second book, mm-hmm. you need to go in, when you're going to read these books, you need to go in with an open mind and your seatbelt securely fastened.
What is synthetic telepathy, Michael?
That is the description of the bidirectional process between a human mind, which I discuss in the new book, believed to be the process by which a supercomputer is able to hack into a human person's, a human being's mind without their knowledge, without their being aware of it, and extract information, and having thoughts and their brain resonance frequency being read and converted into text in real time. And also, it's a bidirectional process, so through which both information can be taken out and information can be transferred back in. And that's where you get the remotely induced mind control, the mood alterations, the urge inductions. So that's really basically the basic definition. It's a relationship. It's a relationship between a supercomputer and the human mind. It's a bidirectional information exchange process.
Let's go to the phones, Michael, and take some questions for you and stories. Richard in North Carolina to get us started on the Wild Card Line. Hi, Rich. Good morning. Is he with us? Nope. Going once, going twice. Let's try Veronica, though, out there in California in Channel Island. Hey, Veronica, welcome to the program.
Thank you for taking my call.
Sure,
I just want to tell you, Michael, thank you for being so brave, you know, to tell the truth and to share your story with the world, because this is happening to so many people. And most of their friends and people that they know think they're crazy. And so it's really important for people like you to speak out and to do all this. From my understanding, this technology was created by the Department of the Navy. It's called HSCADA, meaning Human Secondary Control and Data Acquisition. And there's actually a book about it by a prominent physician. But if you want to see pictures of one of these things, George, I've got pictures. Of an implant that was removed by a very prominent television doctor. And these things are, you know, happening daily to people, and it's just ridiculous. But is this being perpetrated by the federal government? And also the medical boards are protecting doctors that are trying to remove these implants from people. I know that there's a case right now in Atlanta, Georgia, where there's a doctor, and of course I can't mention the name because there's litigation going on, but basically the medical board over there has said that this doctor is not allowed to remove any kind of semiconductor devices out of people.
They literally label it like that, huh?
Yes, yes. Huh. And it's becoming more and more prominent, and like I said, I do have photographs.
Yeah, send it to me, George at coasttocoastam.com.
I will, but I have to. I don't know if I can send them to you until after the litigation, but they are there. I can send you the paper from the university that created this technology. And yeah, it's you know, people, ladies and gentlemen, please listen very carefully to what Michael's trying to tell you, because we could all be victims of this technology. And again, I just want to applaud you, Michael, for being so brave to put the truth out there. And thank you, George, for all you do for all of us.
Very welcome. And Michael, why don't you react a little bit to Veronica's stuff?
Yeah, I wanted to say what was just said is completely accurate. And I also, to react to that, to let the people, there are targeted individuals, and everyone else who's not targeted is referred to as a non-target. But as I wrote in my newest book, The Invisible Crime Part 2, just because you're not a targeted individual today doesn't mean you can't or won't become one tomorrow.
Good point. Do they select people generally because they're trying to get rid of them, or what are the reasons? Like in your case, of course, you told us why, but no harm to date has come to you, thank God. But how do they generally select people?
You know, I really don't know their vetting process and why they select certain people, but I know that certain demographics, in my research, they will experiment and gather information from groups, people from a certain age, from a certain race, from similar backgrounds, and have those people under a certain testing program. And then, but covering the full gamut from low-income people to highly successful people that are extremely wealthy. But I believe that what they're trying to do is test on specific points of the population, because as I said, this crime is being scaled to the entire human population. That's the end goal. So I believe they're seeing by experimenting on individuals and groups of individuals that are similar, they're trying to change or convert someone. They're certainly their way of thinking and seeing how effective they can be in doing that. And also, what also my research indicates is that they're also collecting data on how a target individual reacts to these, to being experimented on, how they're able to survive, how their ability to survive with insurmountable odds against them. How are they able to survive? What are they doing to continue to live, and how are they able to live their lives when their lives have been so compromised by this invisible crime?
What was the reason for the second book, The Invisible Crime Part 2?
The second book it's a combination of my ongoing story, my personal detailed journey and journal from a life of freedom to one of human enslavement, but also it's 7 years worth. Since I first submitted the first book, 7 years have transpired, and I've collected a lot of data and the feedback that I got from the first book from so many people around the world, and I've collected it's a mix of both my personal experience and those experiences which have been shared to me by other target individuals. So it represents everything in this new book. This is all brand new information, and much of it I don't believe you're going to find anywhere else, and certainly other people aren't talking about a lot of the different things that I mentioned in this new book. So in that respect, it's kind of groundbreaking. I would say it's really dissecting the different aspects of the crime. As I said, the organized stalking, the electronic harassment, and then the remotely induced mind control, explaining how they work, the people that how the stalking works, how where the funding comes from. What the goals are. I go into much greater detail in this second book in terms of describing the signs and symptoms of being mind controlled, things to look for, the different unacknowledged special access programs that are believed to be clandestine U.S. military projects using target individuals as test beds. So that's really... And also, there's a couple of other things which we may not get a chance to go into. I also include some other aspects of this crime that I don't believe we've spoken about on this show before. Margellan's disease, and more specifically, these unidentified, unknown fiber spools that are can also often be found in the homes of target individuals, which I refer to in the book as cocoons, these tiny little, and I had several of these taken to a North Carolina agricultural center, and they were not able to identify these tiny little fiber spools that I brought to them, and they said they'd never seen anything like it before. So And Morgellons disease itself, believed to be part of the U.S. biological weapons program. That's something that we didn't talk about. It's also believed to be, alleged to be a man-made pathogen or parasite, and that's a synthetic microorganism, which, as I said, part of the U.S. biological weapons program, believed to be. And then people who do have this condition are routinely falsely labeled with delusional parasitosis. Although their claims may be real, criminal, intentional misdiagnosis can be used as a weapon against the victim.
Okay, back to the calls. Jay, somewhere out there on the wild card line. Jay, go ahead.
Good morning, gentlemen. Thank you so much for the show. And I just wanted to confirm to what the guest is saying and maybe get in to my own testimony a bit.
What happened to you?
What happened to me? What I don't know is how long I had been one. I part of me wonders, if you look at it from like the predestination point of view of a biblical view, if you get into that aspect of it, then you think you are since childhood. And then I wonder if it goes into that more. But then when I became aware of it, at first I just thought it was extreme censorship. Extreme censorship online and getting banned and so forth and edited and whatnot. And then when I realized it and started to study it and research it and the depth of it and what it goes to, including the noise harassment, neighbors and people messing with you, even that within your home, because you kind of want to stay at home so you don't have to deal with it, but at the same time, that's where they want to keep you. But with the dreams, he's right on there how they can corrupt and manipulate and turn your dreams. And the only way I can really describe, like when you have the uncontrollable urges of, let's say, hunger, lust, or something of that sort, it's almost like possession, because it's like you really are not in control. You're fighting a losing battle. And it's like almost until you give in, then it's not going to go away. As far as the mood swings and the suicidal thoughts and the despair that come out of nowhere, I mean, he's right on with all of it. And people need to understand, you know, this is described in different ways. It's adult bullying, spiritual warfare, being gaslit by Satan, and they say it is demonic at the highest level. Different people become gang stalked or targeted individuals or TIs for different reasons. As far as, let's say, the very religious or devout or holy, righteous people, which at this time I was very much so.
Well, and like, why'd they target you, Jay? What's your opinion on that?
Well, I can tell you for sure that it really got ramped up after I had a 33rd degree Grandmaster Mason who played me and lied to me about who and what he was, and basically he pumped and fished me for information, got my trust and so forth, and then turned on me and made bail threats to me through another radio show chat thing online that they do, veiled in only the way I could see it and so forth, and after that it very much ramped up.
Well, let's get your reaction to this, Michael, before the break, and that is, how many people are under electronic harassment like Jay is?
In my research and what's been reported to me is that certainly at there are different levels of being targeted individual. There's no question about that, especially when you compare the victimization against from one person to another. It's very easy to see that there are differences, but there are also commonalities. To answer your question, it's supposed to be an estimate is 1% of the population, of the global population, which would be 75
million
victims worldwide.
That's a lot.
Huge amount, an enormous amount of victims.
What's their goal? What's their end game? What do they want?
It's slowly I mean, this program, in one format or another, has been out for over 60 years, and it's being refined, and it's continuing to escalate with all the new technologies and all the different classified technologies that are being used to make this crime possible. It really is a crime of technology. It's the misuse and abuse of classified technologies, and I would say that there are people out there that are victims that aren't being overtly made aware of it. A huge number. I can't even put a number on that. But as I said in our last show, that it is possible that the this technology, these classifying technologies, have been out estimated for over 60 years, and the implantation specifically with the advanced nanotechnology biomedical devices, that's estimated that is so widespread that it is quite possible that as many as a third to as much as 50% of Americans have already been implanted.
50%? That's unbelievable. We're coming back for final calls next on Coast to Coast AM. And welcome back to Coast, our final segment here with Michael Fitzhugh Bell, his latest book, The Invisible Crime Part 2. Michael, where do people get your books?
My books are, both of them are available through both of my websites, www.invisiblecrime.com, and the brand new website, www.michaelfbell.com. Also, the book is available at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and wherever fine books are sold.
Are you concerned that they're out to get you?
I am. I'm concerned. But, I mean, it's confirmed to me that certainly any level of being a target individual is awful and terrible, even at the mildest levels. But in the new book, I describe what my level is, as I refer in the new book as people that are at the highest level of being targeted as signature or hard targets, and that is literally the 1% of the 1%. So out of the 75 estimated million victims worldwide, I'm at a level, the 1% of that, which would be part of 750,000 people that are living at the highest levels of victimization.
Explain to us again who the cabal may be.
The cabal is believed to be, it's a secret faction or a secret group that is really a combination, believed to be a combination or part of the U.S. military black ops, multinational corporations, and the global criminal syndicate or the mafia. So the cabal is out of those. There is a very extremely secretive, powerful group within those three elements, known as the cabal, C-A-B-A-L, and as I said before, not to be confused with the Kabbalah spelled with a K. This
right.
Cabal is a secret group or faction that has targeted me for sure.
Next up, we go to Chicago. Steve's turn, east of the Rockies. Steve, go ahead.
Good morning, gentlemen, George and Michael.
Hi there.
Michael, I'm certainly very sorry to hear that you're going through this, and I agree with a previous caller, Jay, who said this really seems like a possession, and it seems like even though technology is involved, that it's ultimately a spiritual attack. And my question to you is, are you a spiritual man, and have you prayed for or considered praying for healing and protection for what's happening to you?
That's a great question. I am a spiritual person. I do say my prayers. I do go to church, and I believe I get some kind of relief, certainly in my mind, by doing that. And I believe if you are a spiritual person, acknowledging the process of being spiritual and certainly embracing whatever your religious beliefs are is of a great comfort at times when there is no comfort to be found, when there's nothing left but your convictions and your beliefs, your religious beliefs. And I believe that those, in many ways, and on my worst days, save me and give me the power to complete one day and go into the next.
With everything that's happened in your life, how old are you, Michael, if I can ask?
I'm 55.
55 years old.
I'll be 56 next month.
And this has been happening to you for how long?
Well, that's a great question. I was overtly aware of it as early as 2000, shortly after 9/11, shortly after they changed some of the laws, some of the Patriot Act, which was changed shortly after 9/11. That's when I became aware. It usually starts with the organized stalking for most victims, and I became aware of that as early as 2001, but it could have been going on for much longer, years before that, just on a level that I wasn't being made aware of it in the way that I'm being hard targeted right now.
Next up, we go to Catherine in Sacramento, California. Hello, Catherine. Welcome to the program.
Hello. Hi. Thank you for taking my call. I love you always, George.
Oh, thank you.
And Michael, I had to call in because it just breaks my heart for what you're going through as an empath and a very intuitive and psychic abilities. I could pick up your pain. And you were saying some things after I was thinking them very strongly, which was the Nazi thing and the psychopath and the sociopath. And it's very obvious that this world, with what people do to each other, that there are a lot of those on this planet. And so it's completely believable. And I wanted to see if you have tried anything for your PTSD, which you obviously have to have for your sleeping. I've had a hard time with trauma and PTSD, and the only way not to wake up every night with panic attacks is with medication.
Wow. Which is not recommended for a lot of people. Michael?
I'm not sure if I understand the question. I'm so sorry. Say it again.
I was believing that you probably have PTSD from what you're going through, which could cause
yes.
panic attacks when you go to sleep and wake you up.
Yes.
And that if you have tried some medications, because there is one that was only one that would work for me to keep me from waking up from panic attacks every single night.
I have not tried anything I'm open to trying, and I have meditated, and I do try to get to the point where I can perhaps reduce the intensity of the attacks that I experience, the panic portion, the electronic jolts that I sustain nightly. But I haven't found anything that completely is able to overcome what was happening to me. Although what you said, perhaps meditation, and if you do find some format that works for you, is any relief at this point, at this level of targeting, any relief is welcome and noted and is noticeable. And so it is important to keep your mind open and to try new things, even things that you may not really believe might help, because sometimes just a small bit of improvement can mean a huge impact on your life.
How many people are committed to institutions because of this, and people think they're going nuts and they're not?
Well, I'll tell you, in the first book, I describe what happened to me. I told the truth to the authorities. I personally was, as I write about in great detail in the first book, was wrongly institutionalized three times within a six-month period. And I'll tell you, when I was there, nearly all the people, then there were some seriously mentally ill people that were in there with me. But I could also see, looking back on it, many of the people that were there were reporting exactly what targeted individuals are reporting, specifically with the voice-to-skull technology. A lot of these people were hearing voices. Now, I didn't know about being a targeted individual back then, but when I look back on it, those people that were being wrongly institutionalized were, in my mind, targeted individuals.
Let's take a few more calls here. Thank you, Catherine. Appreciate your call. Wayne in British Columbia, welcome to the program. Go ahead, Wayne.
Thanks for having me on.
Sure thing.
I'd like to back up everything he says. It's true. I believe it's New World Order based. I believe that they target enemies of the New World Order. It's not spiritual attacks. That's gaslighting. I've been a victim of street theater, electronic harassment, and gang stalking, and various other torture, no-touch torture methods. So I back up 100% what this guy's saying. It's true.
Why you? Why, have you ever answered that question for yourself?
Why anybody? I just think they're guinea pigs. I think that it's enemies of the New World Order, people that think differently. Your listeners are, you know, our prime candidates.
Oh, you got that right. So Wayne and Michael, wrong place at the wrong time? Is that a possibility, Michael?
Certainly is. It certainly is. Meeting the wrong people, being in the wrong place at the wrong time, upsetting the wrong person, what I understand in my research indicates is that some people are chosen randomly. So sometimes there's nothing that you could have done to prevent it. There are so many different reasons that it's hard to pinpoint just one. But yes, certainly being in the wrong place at the wrong time and encountering the wrong groups of people are a real possibility.
Rick's in St. Louis, first time caller. Hey, Rick, let's get you in here.
Hey, guys, this is my first time. Michael, I'm glad to hear you come forward on your situation. And I was wondering if you've heard of or if you're familiar with the 11/11 phenomenon and if you had any experiences of that with your situation. And the reason I ask that is because after spending about a year on Archuleta Mesa as a caretaker, my wife and I both experienced this phenomenon along with a lot of the stuff that you're experiencing. But I was just curious if you've also ran into this.
What kind of phenomena are you referring to specifically?
11/11, seeing the numbers.
Seeing certain numbers all over the place, Michael.
Oh, yes, to some degree, I have to say that it seems to be, from me, certain, this group at least the one that has targeted me, are very much, they embrace numbers of various, whether it's the number 13, a very unlucky number, or, you know, demonic numbers like 6 or 666. I've noticed that sometimes these numbers, I can't help but notice every little thing that happens to me now. So I would say yes, to some degree I've noticed that. And also another thing that I talk about in the new book is being given the notion to look to see what time it is, only to see that the clock is either exactly right down to the second at the top of the hour or the bottom of the hour, exactly at let's say 12 o'clock or 12:30. So if that may be something that's certainly indicating numbers to me, and me being remotely what I believe to be induced to look at the clock exactly, or being woken up specifically at different points of the night, the same time each and every night, when you look over at that clock, it will be exactly to the minute, to the second. So I believe that numbers certainly play a part in my targeting, for sure.
Michael, does anybody go to jail for doing this to people?
Not to my knowledge. It seems to me that it's kind of like the mafia is a good example. I mean, how many of those people are, I mean, we know it exists. We know it's worldwide. How many of those people, not very many of those people, go to jail for anything? They seem to be able to carry on with their crimes, never being held accountable for their actions. Are people... I don't know of anyone that has gone to jail, for this specific crime. But this crime is at the highest level of a crime. It's way beyond a felony. This is what you would call a capital crime, an offense to which, if prosecuted, people just like the Nazis would be subjected.
Sure would. It's like a crime against humanity, to be sure. Thank you, Michael. The name of the book, The Invisible Crime, Part 2. Get them both. For Dan Galante, Tom Danheiser, Lisa Lyon, Lex Lonehood, Sean Latasseur, Stephanie Smith, Chris Burleson, George Knapp. I'm George Norrie. Somewhere out there on Coast to Coast AM. We'll see you on our next edition. Until then, be safer.